W.F. Howes presents an unabridged recording of How to Mend a Broken Heart, Lessons from the World of Neuroscience by Ziella Bryars, narrated by Antonia Beamish. Chapter 1. Broken-Hearted. Hello, my broken-hearted friend. I'm so sorry this has happened. Who knew something that sounded as sweet and enticing as romance could also punch so hard? How much more validating it would be if a broken heart were called by some impressive medical name that you could announce with great seriousness to all your friends. Did you hear? Amy has heartbreak. My God, what bad luck to catch it right at the end of winter. You could take sick leave. Your symptoms would be respected, and you wouldn't think you were going mad when you didn't bounce back as quickly as you'd like. You would have contracted heartbreak, and everyone would take it as seriously as you. The reality of how bad heartbreak can be first hit me when, years ago, I came down with a particularly bad case of the broken hearts. I have, in fact, been heartbroken many a time, but this was the breakup that knocked me the hardest. I was at that dangerous meeting point of being both completely loved up and utterly unprepared. And almost worse than the shock was how embarrassed I felt. It had been a kind of undefined relationship without a proper name, sometimes on, sometimes off, sometimes clear and sometimes not. I felt like I wasn't entitled to feel as bad as I did. And yet it was as if I had been punched in the gut. That was when, without warning, I was suddenly unable to eat. The smell of food, the idea of it, everything to do with eating made me nauseous. The experience was like having gastric flu, but I wasn't sick in the traditional sense. I was heartbroken. I am not someone who ever misses a meal. I do not forget to have lunch because I'm too busy. I love food. I love cooking. I love thinking about food and thinking about cooking. To be so in shock and so sad that my stomach hurt was like nothing I had ever experienced before. For someone who had never felt a tie between her body and her heart, it was a fascinating, if upsetting, realization. My broken heart had temporarily broken me. Luckily for me, I had a very close and incredibly clever friend to help me through it. A neuroscientist, no less. My wise, kind, brilliant friend Sarah, who spends her days scanning brains while the rest of us send emails, was, by wonderful chance, the person by my side at that sad and confusing moment. Her way of talking about heartache came from a completely different place to the advice I was used to. I didn't want to eat, she asked. Well, that made sense. In periods of stress, the HPA axis is activated, resulting in higher levels of the stress hormone cortisol and increased autonomic arousal. And these changes can impact the digestive system. Didn't I know that? No, I did not. My tips on heartbreak came from magazines. I thought I was meant to get a haircut. Her way of looking at the world gave me hope and guidance in those awful first few weeks. Her scientific approach to life, rooted in fact, was so refreshing and calm. So much so that I started trying to log all the useful little nuggets of information she would give me. I saved articles she sent me. I wrote down things she said in notes on my phone. I even started to seek out scientific studies on my own, not only for my future dumped self, but for the many coffees, movie nights, and meals ahead I knew I would have with my fellow heartbroken friends. The more articles I read and the more I talked to Sarah, the more reassurance I felt. Every time she started a sentence with, "Did you know that research shows?" I felt a tiny bit saner. There was such relief in hearing that the sensations I was experiencing were not down to madness or weakness. They were not me being melodramatic or silly or naive. Each fact and each study I read made me realise that I wasn't personally having some overly dramatic reaction or breaking down. This was my body and my brain recovering from a real, documented and scientifically recognised impact. In fact, in a way, the process I was going through was what made me, along with every other human on the planet, so brilliant, rather than making us weak. I had a chemistry teacher once who told our class that when he got into debates with his more poetic friends, they would become frustrated about how analytically he saw the world, how scientists dissected everything and didn't look at something like a beautiful rose and just say, "Wow, that's so stunning and magical." "But don't you see," he said to his class full of cynical teenagers, "the atoms and molecules that make up that rose, the pigment that makes it red and not pink, the chance of it blooming or existing at all in the minuscule strip of livable atmosphere that skirts the outside of our planet, are what make it so much more mind-blowing to look at." For once, I think our entire class was listening. I remember feeling in that moment that he probably saw more magic in a bunch of flowers than the rest of us. Now, I am as guilty as the next person of reading trashy magazines and crying along to breakup songs. I went through a country music phase for this very reason. But sometimes, we need a little more than a haircut or a playlist to help us through an experience like this. Sometimes, we need something more solid to hold on to. Understanding what was happening inside my body and mind not only helped me to be kinder to myself, but also steered me towards some helpful coping strategies. Our instincts are not always the best during this time, so a little help from the world of science can be a useful tool. Do you want to know what is extra unfair about being heartbroken? Our IQ actually decreases. Our logic and reasoning are impaired, and our judgment is altered. I know. What a treat. Like we haven't got enough to deal with right now. Studies on how emotions affect logical reasoning show that the state we are in when we are heartbroken has a clear effect on our performance in even relatively simple tasks. Our competence actually goes down. We are also more likely to draw illogical conclusions as our emotions continue to have an impact on our reasoning. And on top of this, studies on negative emotional states and their influence on logic show that any beliefs we have going into a task or scenario are more likely than usual to outweigh our normal powers of deduction. A heartbroken person is a biased, illogical muddle, scientifically speaking. If ever I needed my brain to be working at full capacity, it was in those first few post-breakup weeks. I could have done with some increased reasoning, thank you very much, but apparently that is not the way it goes. Not only are we navigating painful new terrain, but we are actually less clever as we do so. This may not be the most positive heartbreak fact to start off with, but honestly, isn't it better to know? Don't we want to understand what's going on inside our confused minds right now? To know that as we struggle more than usual in this difficult time, there is a reason for it. A scientific, studied in labs reason. We don't have to feel frustrated or think we are losing our minds. We don't have to feel crazy or silly on top of feeling sad. We can breathe a sigh of relief and know that this is happening to everyone's brain in this state. This is normal. This is measurable. This even shows up on an MRI scan. If we can understand what is going on inside us as we process our broken hearts, we have a much greater chance of coping with the side effects and ultimately recovering. Although I didn't end up taking a scientific path in my career, instead writing things like rom-coms rather than groundbreaking research papers, I think perhaps my chemistry teacher planted a little seed in my mind that is best nurtured by data and statistics. The calm reassurance I feel on reading studies about heartbreak definitely seems to come from an inner science geek I didn't realize I had. There is such relief in knowing that heartbreak happens on a neurophysiological level, that it is real, and that it affects us to a measurable degree. The clever neuroscientists out there, my best friend among them, who study and research the inner workings of our brains, not only have the science to explain what is happening to us, but can actually help us in this difficult time. I know Sarah helped me. I also know that without our conversations, I would have had more questionable haircuts, done more drunk dialing, and made more impulse purchases. Understanding the impact that a breakup can have on our bodies and minds can help us figure out what we are going through and how to recover from it. For me, my conversations with Sarah and my new love of heartbreak science not only restored my ravenous and sometimes commented on appetite, but also helped me to come out the other side and feel like myself again. Chapter 2. What just happened? If you're anything like me, you may be spending a lot of time right now staring at the ceiling.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.